Alhamdulillah Rabbil Alameen. Salat wa salam ala Sayyidina Mursaleen Nabiyina Muhammad wa ala alihi wa sahbihi ajma'in. Here we have Shaykh Asim al-Quryuti. He's a teacher in Jami' Imam Riyadh, the Faculty of Hadith. I don't think the Shaykh really needs an introduction, but he's travelled a lot. He had personal interactions with Shaykh al-Alam Muhaddith, Shaykh Muhammad al-Bani, rahimahullah. And the Shaykh has travelled extensively to India and other places in study of Hadith. The Shaykh also graduated and got his doctorate in 1983, which is over 30 years ago. So the Shaykh has a long history of ilm, and today he's going to give a lecture on how to understand the Sunnah.
Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Alhamdulillah. والصلاة والسلام الأتمان الأكملان على سيدنا ونبينا إمام المتقين محمد وعلى آله وصحبه ومن سار على نهجه إلى يوم الدين.
The Shaykh began by starting with the Basmala and praising Allah and sending peace and blessings upon the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the Imam of the pious, and may Allah have blessings and peace on Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam and his companions.
أما بعد فإني في هذا اللقاء سعيد بأمرين. الأول بلقاء الإخوة من جنسيات وأصول متعددة. وما جمعنا إلا هذا الدين العظيم ولله الحمد والمنة.
The Shaykh said, I'd like to begin this by lecture by showing his gratitude and happiness that he is here for two reasons. One of the reasons is that he has seen so many brothers from different nationalities, and nothing gathers us here except of this religion of Allah, and all praises Allah for this.
والسعادة الأخرى ما ذكره لي الإخوة عن هذا المكان كان معبدا للكفر والشرك بالله عز وجل وأصبح منارة للإيمان بالله واليوم الآخر وهذا لا شك مما يسعد المسلم وهو من بشائر أن المستقبل لهذا الدين مهما ازداد الشر.
Shaykh said the second reason why he's happy is because the brothers have told the Shaykh that this place used to be a synagogue, a temple, a place where shirk and kufr used to occur, but now it's become a masjid and a symbol of iman, for which Allah is believed in and in the last day as well. So the Shaykh said that Muslims become happy when they see this kind of change, and he said that this is also a sign that the future is also good for this religion, no matter how bad we think the situation is.
والله سبحانه وتعالى قد قال في محكم كتابه والذي أرسل رسوله بالهدى ودين الحق ليظهره على الدين كله ولو كره الكافرون ولو كره المشركون وغير ذلك من الأدلة على أن العاقبة للإسلام انتشارا وعزة وتمكينا.
The Shaykh said that Allah has told us in the book in many places that he has sent the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam with guidance and the upright religion. Even if the mushriks and if the kuffar have enmity and hatred towards the religion spreading. So the Shaykh said that there's many evidences to suggest that Islam is not going to end, it's going to spread with honor and stability.
وهذا أيها الإخوة والأخوات يحتم علينا أمرا عظيما وهو أن نحرص على الاستقامة كما أمر الله عقيدة وأخلاقا فيما بيننا نحن معشر المسلمين ومع غيرنا بحكم الجوار، وأن نكون صورة ناصعة تكون سبباً من الأسباب في إقبال غير المسلمين على هذا الدين العظيم.
The Shaykh said that it's obligatory upon his brothers and sisters that we preserve the steadfastness of the religion, that we preserve the aqidah, the creed and the manners of this religion between ourselves as brothers and also within society as a whole, so that we can become and show a good example, a sincere example of Islam. And this will be a cause from the many causes of non-Muslims entering into this great religion.
أما الموضوع الذي أتكلم حوله إن شاء الله بعنوان كيف نفهم السنة.
The topic today is how to understand the Sunnah.
هذا الأمر مهم جدا، وكان الناس قديما في خير عظيم. وإذا سمعوا كلام الله وكلام رسوله صلى الله عليه وسلم ما كان شأنهم إلا التسليم لما قال الله وقال رسوله صلى الله عليه وسلم.
It's important to know that this ummah has always been upon a great deal of goodness, and whenever they heard the speech of Allah and the speech of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, they accepted it wholeheartedly.
ويخبر الله سبحانه وتعالى عن شأن المؤمنين فيقول إنما كان قول المؤمنين إذا دعوا إلى الله ورسوله أن يقولوا سمعنا وأطعنا وأولئك هم المفلحون.
The Shaykh said that Allah tells us in the Quran that the attitude of the believer is that when they hear Allah and His Messenger calling them towards something, they say, "We hear and we obey," and these are the people that are successful.
وازدادت في الحقيقة فتن في الآونة الأخيرة في الطعن في السنة في بعض الجوانب وفي ثوابت لهذا الدين بدعوى المعارضة بين السنة والقرآن.
The Shaykh said that there's an extra level of fitna that has occurred now, where people are rejecting the Sunnah, and they are looking at ways where they seem to find some kind of contradiction.
والسنة لا شك أنها بلا نزاع بين أهل العلم قاطبة أنها هي المصدر الثاني من مصادر التشريع، بل هي المصدر الثاني.
The Shaykh said that the Sunnah, there is no doubt about it, that it is knowledge and is considered as a second reference of Islamic legislation that the scholars are agreed upon.
حقيقة الأمر أن السنة هي وحي من الله، كما أن القرآن وحي ولكنه يتلى، والسنة وحي ولكنه غير متلو.
The Shaykh said that in reality the Sunnah is wahi, just like the Quran is wahi. There is no differentiation between the two, except that the Quran is recited, whereas the Sunnah is not something that you can recite.
وينبني على ذلك أنه ما دام أن القرآن وحي وهو من كلام الله عز وجل، والسنة وحي من الله سبحانه وتعالى، أنه لا يمكن أن يكون هنالك معارضة بين كلام الله عز وجل، ولا يوجد آية تعارض آية، ولا حديث يعارض آية، ولا حديث يعارض حديثا على وجه الحقيقة.
The Shaykh said, based on this, that we know that the Quran, the Sunnah, all of it is revelation from Allah, so it's impossible to find a contradiction between the Quran or the Sunnah. Not that any ayah can contradict another ayah, or an ayah contradicting a hadith, or a hadith contradicting another hadith in the proper way that it should be understood. The contradiction may be understood from somebody who doesn't understand it properly.
والله عز وجل يقول ولو كان من عند غير الله لوجدوا فيه اختلافا كثيرا فلا يمكن أن يكون هنالك اختلاف بين آيات القرآن ولا بين السنة والقرآن لأن كل ذلك هو من عند الله تبارك وتعالى.
Shaykh said that Allah says in Surah Nisa that if it was from other than Allah, you'd find many contradictions in the Quran. So the Shaykh said that it's not possible to find any contradictions. It's all revelation from Allah. You will not find a sunnah contradicting an ayah from the Quran because all of it is from the same source, which is from Allah.
لهذا يقول أحد الأئمة وهو الإمام ابن خزيمة يقول لا يوجد شيء من التعارض في نصوص القرآن ولا في السنة ومن يدعي أن هنالك تعارض بينها فليأتني به حتى أبين وأوضح أنه لا تعارض بين هذه النصوص.
One of the scholars of Islam, Ibn Khuzaymah, said that it's not possible for a Quran ayah or hadith to contradict one another, or hadith or hadith, or ayah or ayah. And the Shaykh said that, Ibn Khuzaymah said that whoever seems to find a contradiction in these sources of legislation, then come to me so that I can explain how he's misunderstood the contradiction.
فالأصل الأول الذي يجب أن نتنبه له فيما يتعلق بالسنة أنه يجب أن يتثبت المرء من الحديث بأنه من الأحاديث الصحيحة الثابتة عن رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم.
The first thing that we have to pay attention to is when we're looking at the sunnah, we have to realize and we have to establish, is this sunnah? And establish sunnah, is it authentic, reported from the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم or not?
والعلماء اعتنوا بهذا الباب فصنف الصحيحان وغير ذلك من كتب الحديث وأبان العلماء عن صحة الأحاديث التي في غير الصحيحين أن صحيحان تلقتهما الأمة بالقبول وهذا كله من حفظ الله لهذا الدين لما قال إنا نحن نزلنا الذكر وإنا له لحافظون فالسنة هي الموضحة والمبينة لهذا القرآن.
Shaykh said that the scholars throughout the ages have given the Sunnah extreme level of importance. You will find there's two Sahihs. We'll find many books of hadith that have recorded all the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and the Sunnah. There's other scholars that came and they classified the Sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam to the extent that even the two Sunnahs completely agreed that is acceptable and is authentic in and of themselves, and the Ummah is completely agreed upon this without anybody rejecting it. And the Shaykh said that the religion has been promised to be preserved in Surah Hijr, and this is an aspect of that, where the Sunnah is preserved through the way of the scholars.
ولا يمكن أن يكون هنالك شيء فيه تعارض بين الحديث والقرآن إلا أن يكون أحد أمرين لا ثالث لهما. إما أن يكون الحديث ليس بصحيح عن الرسول صلى الله عليه وسلم وإما أن يكون الأمر يرجع إلى ضعف الفهم أو عدم الفهم للحديث وللآية أيضا.
The Shaykh said that it's not possible for the hadith to contradict the sunnah, the sunnah to contradict the Quran or the other way around, except if there are two possible scenarios. Either the actual hadith itself has not been established to be authentic, so a person might find a contradiction with other hadith which are authentic. Or it could be the second reason, that the person who's looking at these texts of the Quran and the Sunnah has a weak understanding or has no understanding to the actual meaning of what the hadith is actually saying or the ayah is saying.
ويحسن أيضا أن ننبه بأن العلماء لما نجد في كلامهم أن هذه الآية تتعارض مع تلك الآية أو هذا الحديث يعارض تلك الآية إنما المقصود في ذلك التعارض في الظاهر فيما يبدو لنا وإلا على الحقيقة ليس هنالك تعارض.
Sometimes you might find some of the scholars, and he said, the Shaykh said that we have to pay attention to this as well. Some of the scholars might say that this ayah seems to contradict this ayah, or this hadith seems to contradict this one. The Shaykh said that the meaning of such a statement from the books of the scholars or from the statements of the ulama is that it's an apparent contradiction, but not an actual contradiction. It appears for it to be a contradiction to us, but the actual meaning is different.
فمن التعارض الباطل ما يروى في حديث لا أصل له عن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم فيما يتعلق بالنساء شاوروهن وخالفوهن هذا حديث مكذوب باطل لا أصل له وهو يخالف الأصل القرآني في الشورى حتى مع النساء بين الرجل وزوجه.
The Shaykh gives an example of how a weak narration contradicts something which is authentic. The Shaykh said that there's a hadith which is completely false, has no basis in Islam, where apparently it's attributed to the Prophet that he said, consult your women, and then whatever they say, do the opposite. Contradict whatever they say completely. The Shaykh said that this is completely rejected, it's a lie against Islam, so there is no real contradiction. In fact, it contradicts the ayah where Allah tells us to consult one another in our affairs. And the Shaykh said this includes husband and wife consulting one another in their affairs.
إذ يقول الله سبحانه وتعالى فيما يتعلق بالرضاعة للولد فإن أراد فصالا أي الزوجان عن تراض منهما وتشاور فلا جناح عليهما. فهذا من الأمثلة التي ذكرت أنه لا يمكن أن يوجد تعارض إلا يكون إما أن يكون هذا الحديث باطلا لا يصح عن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم أو يرجع إلى أن الأمر يحتاج إلى نظر وفهم للنصين الحديث والقرآن.
The Shaykh gives an example. He said that the ayah of breastfeeding, he's saying that if the two partners, the husband and wife, decide that they want to stop breastfeeding their child, based on mutual understanding and based on consultation with one another, then there is no harm in them stopping the breastfeeding at that period. So the Shaykh said that this clearly contradicts the weak narration that we've just quoted, that it's firmly established that we must consult one another. So the Shaykh saying that this is a fine example, but also it goes back to the point that we were saying before. Contradictions really occur either because the actual contradiction is baseless, is based on something which is weak, or that the understanding is not correct and we need to have a more holistic understanding of the text.
كذلك قواعد المهمة لفهم السنة أن تجمع الأحاديث كلها المتعلقة في الموضوع في الباب وينظر إليها مجتمعة ولهذا نجد من كلام أئمتنا كلاما في هذا الموضوع ومنه قول الإمام أحمد الحديث إذا لم تجمع طرقه لم نفهمه والحديث يفسر بعضه بعضا.
The Shaykh said there's another qaida or another principle that we need to have when we're trying to understand the Sunnah. You're saying that every single narration must be brought when we're talking about a particular topic. We must look at all of them. So we gather all the hadith based on that topic. And the Shaykh said there's many statements from the ulama on this, and he quotes Imam Ahmad, where Imam Ahmad said that if not all the hadith are not combined on that one topic, then we won't understand it properly. Rather, all the hadith, they explain one another.
ومن القواعد لفهم السنة أنه يحتاج إلى الفقه في فهم معنى الحديث والتدبر في الروايات وإمكان الجمع بينها مثلا الأحاديث المتعلقة بالنهي عن استقبال القبلة ببول أو غائط وجاءت أحاديث أخرى تدل على الجواز فالجمع بين ذلك كما يذكر أهل العلم بأن هذه التي نهي عن البول فيها تجاه القبلة إذا كانت في الفضاء والخلاء وأما إذا كان الأمر هنالك حواجز وسواتر وجدران فعندئذ الأمر لا يشمل النهي وإن كان لو أمكن اجتناب هذا حتى مع الحواجز والجدران أولى لكن ليس ثمة تعارض بينها.
The Shaykh gives another example of a principle that is needed. He's saying that we need to have fiqh, we need to have the correct understanding when it comes to looking at the hadith. So the Shaykh said that what we need to do in this process is gather the hadith and ponder upon their meanings for us to have the correct understanding. And the Shaykh gives this example that there are some narrations which say that you're not allowed to face the Qibla or turn your back to the Qibla when you are defecating or urinating. But there are other narrations in which the Prophet ﷺ did it, which show that it is permitted. So the Shaykh said that how can we reconcile between this one and that one? So some of the ulama have said that it's not permissible for you to do this out in the open. But if you are surrounded by walls or a curtain or something like that, then it will be permissible for you to face the Qibla or turn your back to Qibla when you are going to the toilet. But the Shaykh said that if we can completely reject or completely avoid both of these scenarios, and this is better. But the point here is that there is no contradiction between the ones that say that you can face the Qibla and the ones that say you can't face the Qibla.
كذلك من الأمور التي تساعد على الفهم السليم للسنة والأحاديث النظر في التاريخ ومعرفة ما يسمى عند أهل العلم بالناسخ والمنسوخ.
Shaykh said there's another way that we can understand the hadith and the sunnah is to know the history of the sunnah and the history of these rulings. And the ulama have talked about this as being nasikh and mansukh, something which is abrogating and something which is abrogated.
مثلا عندنا حديث يقول فيه النبي عليه الصلاة والسلام في الصحيح إنما الماء من الماء بمعنى أنه يجب الغسل عندما يكون هنالك الإنزال فقط أما إن لم يحصل فلا يجب الغسل وهذا صحيح ثابت.
The Shaykh said he's giving you an example now of what is abrogated, what is not. There's narrated in the Sahih that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said water is only for water. You only do ghusl, you only have the spiritual form of washing yourself if you actually ejaculate something. So the Shaykh said that this hadith is quite clear that it's only for ejaculation. If there is no ejaculation, then there is no ghusl. This hadith is completely authentic and affirmed.
بينما هذا الأمر نسخ كان قديما موجودا ثم نسخ هذا الحكم وزال وأصبح الأمر يتعلق بالجماع مجرد حصوله إتيان الإنسان لأهله يجب الغسل سواء حصل الإنزال أو لم يحصل كما جاء صريحا في الحديث أنزل أو لم ينزل.
However, this was later abrogated because there's another hadith which comes that the Prophet ﷺ said that it's obligatory for us to make ghusl as soon as you enter. When contact is made and you've entered into your partner, then ghusl becomes obligatory upon you, even if you do not ejaculate. And this comes in a clear wording where the Prophet ﷺ said, whether you ejaculate or not, you still need to perform the ghusl.
فَالَّذِي لَا يَعْرِفْ الناسخ والمنسوخ وكلام العلماء ومعرفة تواريخ الروايات قد يبدو له أن هذا يتعارض مع ذاك، لكنه حقيقة ليس هناك تعارض، لأن هذا كان في مرحلة وهذا بعد ذلك نسخ الحكم وأزاله.
The Shaykh said that this is extremely important to know what is abrogating and what is abrogated, and knowing the history of the Sunnah. Because if you look at these hadith without this function, you will think that there is a huge contradiction within the Sunnah. But the Shaykh said that there is actually no reality to the contradiction. The Shaykh said that in the beginning something was of a different phase and something was permissible or not permissible. But as the phase changed, the permissibility became abrogated. So there is no contradiction.
قد تأتي السنة أيضا مع القرآن كما أخبر الله عز وجل حرمت عليكم الميتة حرمت عليكم الميتة والدم وتأتي السنة وتوضح وتبين أن هذه الميتة يعني ليست كل الميتة وإنما كما في الحديث حل لنا ميتتان ودمان وكذلك الدم فهنا السنة جاءت موضحة ومبينة لما في هذا القرآن وأبانت أن هذا الدم ليس كل دم مما يحرم وليست هذه الميتة كل ميتة مما تحرم والله عز وجل أمرنا بطاعة رسوله صلى الله عليه وسلم.
Sheikh said that there's also another point that we need to understand is that the Sunnah explains the Qur'an. So Allah says in the Qur'an that it's forbidden from you to eat carrion, meat that has, or animal that has died by itself, and blood. It comes in the ayah. It's not permissible for us to eat animals that die by themselves and blood. But the Shaykh said that the Sunnah explains that there are some kinds of animals which die by themselves and some kind of blood which are permissible. So the Sunnah actually explains that. So some kinds of meat are permissible, or dead animals are permissible if they come from the sea. And some kinds of blood, as the Sunnah has established also, are permissible for us to eat. So the Shaykh is saying that here the command is for us to understand the Sunnah and to obey.
ومن الأمور المعينة على فهم الحديث فهما سليما معرفة سبب ورود الحديث.
Also, another principle for us to understand the hadith and the sunnah correctly is to know the context as to what that hadith came in.
وهذا معين على الفهم كما أن معرفة أسباب النزول تعين على فهم الآية القرآنية كذلك سبب ورود الحديث مهم ومعين على الفهم ولذا اعتنى بها العلماء.
Sheikh said that this is extremely important because in tafsir, the field of tafsir, there's a whole science as to knowing what the context was for the ayah to come down. So the Sheikh saying likewise in the sunnah, it's important for us to understand the context, for understand the sunnah properly. And the ulama have given this a lot of work for us to have that kind of information.
وَلَوْ نَأْخُذُ مِثَالًا عَلَى أَهَمِّيَّةِ سَبَبْ ورود الحديث وكونه معينا على الفهم السليم حديث من سن سنة حسنة فله أجرها وأجر من عمل بها.
Sheikh said that he's going to give an example of why it is important for us to understand the context of a particular hadith or the sunnah so that we can have the correct understanding. The Sheikh said there's a hadith where the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said that whoever starts a new sunnah then he will have the reward of those people who follow that sunnah as well.
فبعض الناس يفهم من هذا الحديث إطلاق جواز العبادات بأشكال وهيئات وصفات وأعداد غير الذي كان في عهد النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم بدعوى أن هذه ليست بدعة وهي سنة حسنة لهذا الحديث في قوله عليه الصلاة والسلام من سن سنة حسنة. فهل استدلالهم هذا صحيح من هذا الحديث أم لا؟ سبب الحديث يوضح لنا وهو الذي يحكم هل هذا الاستدلال صحيح أم خطأ.
The Shaykh says some people take this hadith and they take it very broadly, and they say that acts of worship can be newly invented, either in the way that they do it, in the manner they do it, the amount of times they do it. And what they say is that the Prophet ﷺ has opened the doors for us to do new acts of worship based on the understanding that they've given. And they say that this is not an innovation, it's not a bid'ah. Rather, it's called a sunnah hasana, because the Prophet ﷺ said, "Man sunnah fil Islam sunnah." Whoever starts a new sunnah in Islam, starts something new. So they're saying that this is something good. So the Shaykh saying is that, is this the correct understanding? Does the context of this hadith make us understand it correctly, the way they've understood it, or is there a mistake?
لما نرجع للحديث والرواية وسبب ورود الحديث لما أو متى قال النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم هذا؟ نجد أن المناسبة أنه جاء قوم، خلاصة الأمر جاء قوم يستحقون الصدقة فيهم ما فيهم من علامات الفقر الشديد، فالنبي صلى الله عليه وسلم تلا آيات من الصدقة وحث الصحابة رضوان الله عليهم على التصدق، فجاء أحد الصحابة فبدأ فتصدق، ثم تتابع الناس بالصدقة بعد ذلك، فقال عندئذ النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم من سن سنة حسنة الحديث.
Shaykh said that the context of this hadith gives us the understanding as to why the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam actually said it, or when he actually said it. The Shaykh said that this hadith comes in the context where a group of people that came to Medina and they were in need of sadaqah. They were actually very, very poor. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam stood and he addressed the people reciting ayat of sadaqah, and he told and he encouraged the companions to give in charity. So one of the companions came and he started giving in charity, and then the other companions came behind him, started giving in charity as well. And this is when the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said that whoever starts something will have the reward for those who follow it.
أنا أسألكم هل هذا الذي بدأ بالصدقة وتتابع الناس اقتداء به بالتصدق، هل جاء بأمر جديد لم يكن في الدين بأي وجه من الوجوه، لا هيئة ولا صفة ولا عددا، أم جاء بأمر أمر الله به وهو التصدق وحث عليه النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم؟
Shaykh saying, I want to ask you a question. This sadaqah that this companion gave and those people who followed him in, is it something new that he came with? Is it something that wasn't already established in the manner that it was done, or the type that it was done, or the amount that it was done? Or is it something already established in the Quran, or something that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam had already encouraged us to do from before? What do you think?
جاء بشيء أمر الله به وأمر به النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم. إذن استدلال بعض الناس على فعل أشياء جديدة، إحداث أمور في الدين لم يفعلها رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم ولا صحابته رضوان الله عليهم، وأشياء كثيرة جداً من هذه البدع، حدث ولا حرج مع الأسف الشديد. ويعجب كيف يستدل أحدهم بمن سن سنة حسنة. حسنة أنت بأي مقياس تقيس الحسن والسوء في العمل؟ المقياس قال الله قال رسوله صلى الله عليه وسلم، وإلا أنا أستحسن شيئاً وأنت تستحسن شيئاً وهذا يستحسن شيئاً، ما بقي هنالك دين.
So the brother answered by saying that it was already established, and the Shaykh saying that yes, it was already established. So he's saying that look at the weak and the false understanding that they bring to this hadith, and from this hadith they try to extract more new rulings and new things and new acts of worship that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and the companions never did before. And all of this results in to a snowballing of innovation. So the Shaykh said that you will find them using this hadith to support innovations which have no connection to what actually happened here. So now the Shaykh is saying now that when they innovate these new practices, what is the benchmark between what is good and what is bad? Some of them use their own benchmarks, but the benchmark for what is good and what is bad has been given to us. This is what Allah says and what the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said. The Shaykh said that if we leave the door open to people to create new acts of worship based on what they think is what is good and what is bad, then there will be no religion left.
They had a ikhwani. من أخطر الأمور في الدين أن يحكم العقل ويكون هنالك الإعراض عن القرآن وهدي النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم.
Sheikh said, my brothers, one of the biggest dangers is when we use our intellect to try and understand the religion, so that what ends up happening is we find many contradictions between the Quran and the Sunnah based on what we think using our intellect.
والذي يتدبر هذا الأمر أعني ملاحظة أسباب ورود الحديث تزول إشكالات كثيرة في الفهم والأمثلة كثيرة ولا أريد لأجل عدم الإطالة عليكم ولكن هذا أمر مهم جدا ويزيح الإشكالات التي يثيرها كثير من الناس مع الأسف بحكم الجهل وعدم العلم وبدعوى أن هنالك تعارض بين هذه الأحاديث ولكن في الحقيقة إنما مرد ذلك إلى عدم الفقه وعدم العلم الصحيح فيما بين في النظر فيما بين هذه الأحاديث
Shaykh is saying that it's very important for us to take this point very seriously and ponder on it, that the context of the hadith gives you the correct understanding, and many of the incorrect understandings come about, many problems come about when they don't take this aspect of understanding the sunnah seriously. So the Shaykh is saying that it's very, very important that we look at the whole context of the hadith and of the sunnah. And many of these problems come about when the people find, or they try to attempt to find contradictions, when they don't have the correct knowledge, they don't have fiqh or ilm or the correct understanding of the hadith. So then what happens is that they understand it in an incorrect manner, leading to them believing that they are contradictions.
كذلك من الأصول المهمة لفهم السنة أن ينظر كيف كان فهم الصحابة للحديث؟ كيف فهم السلف هذا الحديث؟ لا يأتي كل إنسان يفهم كما يريد. النبي عليه الصلاة والسلام قال يا أم القوم أقرأهم لكتاب الله. نحن لو كنا في سفر أو في غير سفر ومعنا بعض النساء وفينا امرأة حافظة قارئة بل بالقراءات أيضا وهي أحفظنا للقرآن هل نقدمها تكون إماما لنا في الصلاة؟ إذا قال قائل النبي عليه الصلاة والسلام يقول يا أم القوم أقرأهم لكتاب الله وهي منا من القوم لكن هذا الفهم هل كان عند الصحابة رضوان الله عليهم هل فهموا وتصوروا وكان في عهد رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم أن تؤم المرأة؟ هل هذا كان موجودا؟ مما يدل على أن هذا الفهم ليس بصحيح، فهم باطل.
Shaykh said, there's also another principle when we are trying to understand the Sunnah, is to understand it the way that the companions understood the Hadith, how the Salaf understood the Sunnah. And it's not open for all of us to understand the Sunnah in the way that we want to. And the Shaykh gives an example. The Prophet ﷺ said that the person who should lead the Salah is the one who has the most knowledge of the Qur'an. So the Shaykh said, let's give you an incident, for example, that if you were travelling and you had men and women amongst you, and it happened to be that one of the women was the most knowledgeable of the Qur'an. She had memorized the most, she had the most recitations, etc. Does this mean now, based on this hadith, that the woman is the one who leads the men and everybody in Salah? Some people might turn around and say yes, because the Prophet ﷺ said, whoever amongst you, as in a group of people, knows the most Qur'an, then they should lead. So the Prophet ﷺ has left it open. But the Shaykh is saying that this is an incorrect understanding. Is this how the Salaf understood it? Is this how the companions understood it? Women travelled all the time at the time of the Prophet ﷺ. Has it ever been established that a woman ever led men in Salah? So this clearly shows that this is not the correct understanding, because they've not understood it the way that the Salaf understood it.
وَالصَّحَابَ أَيُّهَا الْإِخْوَةِ وَالْأَخْوَاتِ رَضِيَ اللَّهُ عَنْهُمْ اصْطَفَاهُمُ اللَّهُ لِصَحْبَةِ نَبِيِّهِ صلى الله عليه وسلم كما اصطفاه عليه الصلاة والسلام، وكانوا شديدي الحرص على التأسي والاقتداء به صلى الله عليه وسلم. كان يلبس خاتم من ذهب صلى الله عليه وسلم، فألقى خاتمه، فألقى الصحابة خواتيمهم. كان يصلي النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم بخفيه وهو في الصلاة، نزعهما، فنزع الصحابة، نزع كلهم خفيه، ثم أخبرهم أن جبريل أخبرني أن فيهما أذى. انظروا الاقتداء، يتابعون رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم، يقتدون به. كانت الحمر الأهلية، الحمير المعروفة، ليست حمر الوحش اللي تسمى، كانت مباحة، يجوز جائز من أكلها. وكانوا في غزوة والحاجة شديدة والقدور تغلي باللحم، يريدون أن يأكلوا، جاء تحريمها، وأمرهم النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم بإراقة هذه القدور بما فيها، فجاءوا وأراقوها. كانوا يصلوا إلى بيت المقدس أولا، وهم في الصلاة في مسجد قباء، في مسجد قباء، وفي قبلتين البداية، في يصلون الناس إلى بيت المقدس، جاءهم المخبر وهم في الصلاة عن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم أن القبلة تحولت. ما صبروا، قالوا نروح نتأكد من الرسول صلى الله عليه وسلم بعد ذلك نشوف. وهم في الصلاة استداروا واتجهوا تجاه الكعبة واستدبروا بيت المقدس. نصوص كثيرة لا تكاد تحصر في حرص الصحابة رضوان الله عليهم على الاقتداء والتأسي بالنبي عليه الصلاة والسلام. هذا كله يؤكد لنا هذا الأصل، أنه يجب أن نفهم القرآن ونفهم السنة وفق ما كان عليه صحابة النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم.
The Shaykh said that the Sahabas, radiallahu anhum, Allah chose them to be the companions of the Prophet ﷺ, because they were very eager to follow the Sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam properly. And the Shaykh gave us a few examples. For example, at the time of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, at the beginning, he used to have a ring made out of gold, and then he threw it away when it became prohibited, and they did the same thing without asking how or why. They wanted to follow the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam in every way. And there was another incident where the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was praying with his leather shoes, khuf, and he took them off during the prayer. And the companions saw the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam in the prayer, took his shoes off, so they followed him and they took the shoes off as well. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said that, "I did it because Jibreel told me to remove it because there was something impure on it." Well, why did they do it? Because they wanted to follow the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam with the utmost eagerness. There's also another example where donkey meat, used to be permissible. And it was in one of the battles that there was an extreme level of starvation. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and the companions, it was permitted for them to do it. But then the prohibition came from the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and he told them to empty out their vessels. From now on, it's not being permitted for us anymore. And they emptied their vessels out with this donkey meat straight away. There's also another incident when they were actually praying in the salah, and they were facing Bayt al-Maqdis. The Shaykh said in the beginning it was Qiblatayn, and then in Quba as well, it happened as well. They were facing Bayt al-Maqdis, and the information came to them that the Qibla has now been changed to Makkah. They didn't wait and see. They didn't say, "Shall we go and see what the Prophet ﷺ is actually saying?" Whilst they were in Salah, they changed. And the Shaykh said there were so many examples of showing how they were eager to follow the Sunnah straight away when it came to them, because they wanted to follow the Sunnah properly. The Shaykh saying that all of this reinforces the fact that there is a huge principle here, is that when we're trying to understand the Quran and the Sunnah, we must understand it according to the way that the companions understood it.
لهذا اعتنى العلماء علماء الإسلام في كتبهم في كتب الحديث بجمع أقوال الصحابة وأفعالهم رضي الله عنهم في كتب السنة. نجد في صحيح البخاري في تراجم الأبواب عند العناوين يذكر آثار الصحابة في سنن أو في جامع الترمذي في مقدمة سنن ابن ماجة في مصنف عبد الرزاق ومصنف ابن أبي شيبة كتب الطحاوي والبيهقي وغيرها كثير من الجمع للآثار المروية عن الصحابة رضوان الله عليهم. لماذا؟ لأنه لابد أن نفهم ونفقه هذا الدين وفق الفهم الذي كان عليه الصحابة، لأنهم وضحوا وبينوا لنا أحسن تبيان.
The Shaykh said that the scholars throughout the ages have given this point a great deal of importance. So he said that you find that the books of hadith have gathered the statements and the actions of the companions. Imam Bukhari in his Sahih, you'll find within the titles of different chapters, he will have the statements and the actions of the companions in there. Imam Tirmidhi did the same thing. Ibn Majah, in the introduction of his Sunnah, had many statements and actions of the companions. There's another scholar, Abdul Razak, and Ibn Abi Shayba, another scholar, they've got Musannif, a huge compilation of just statements and actions of the companions, Imam al-Tahawi, Imam al-Bayhiqi, and the list goes on, the Shaykh said. Why did they do this? Why did they exert so much effort? Because they wanted to understand the religion the correct way, the way that the companions understood it, because they are the ones who understood it the best and were able to relay its explanation in the best way to us.
ومن المهم و يعين طالب العلم أو الناظر والدارس والمتفقه ولا بد أن يرجع إلى كلام أهل العلم إلى شراح الحديث ليعرف الفهم السليم لهذا الحديث. والنبي عليه الصلاة والسلام يقول: من يريد الله به خيرا يفقهه في الدين. الآيات والأحاديث تحتاج إلى فقه، إلى فهم سليم. ليست المسألة حفظ بلا فهم للمعاني وبلا تتبر. وكلما فهم الإنسان الآية والحديث فهما سليما بالرجوع إلى كتب التفسير وبالرجوع إلى كتب شروح الحديث، كلما قلت دائرة التعارض الذي قد يظهر للإنسان، كلما أمكن الجمع بين هذه الأحاديث إن ظهر له أن هنالك شيء من المعارضة بين بعضها بعضا. وكما قلنا التعارض هذا في التصور وليس في الحقيقة، لأن كله من الله.
Shaykh said it's very important for us to realize that if you want to understand and study the Sunnah correctly, that the biggest way and the biggest aid for you to get the correct understanding is going back to the statements and the books of the scholars, the books that they've explained the Hadith and the Sunnah in. This gives you the correct understanding. Because the Prophet ﷺ said that whoever Allah wills good for will give them the correct understanding of the religion. So the Shaykh said that if you want to understand the Sunnah properly, you need to understand the message behind it. And it's not enough for us just to memorize these hadith and the Sunnah without knowing its correct meaning and message, without going back to the ulama. So the Shaykh said that if you go back to the ulama, we will have the correct understanding, we'll be able to ponder on it correctly. The Shaykh said if you want to understand the Quran, you need to go to the tafsir. If you want to understand the hadith, you need to go back to the books that have explained the Sunnah. And the more you do this, the less contradiction you will find in it. He said the contradiction only comes when we leave the statements and the books of the ulama. And when we understand what the ulama have said, we are able to reconcile what people might see as contradictory. And the Shaykh said that this again reinforces what we said before, that contradictions usually occur when a person has their own false understanding. They perceive there to be a contradiction when in reality everything is coherent.
وأنا أعطيكم قاعدة مهمة فيما يتعلق بالشبهات التي يطرحها بعض الملاحدة أو بعض الذين ينتسبون إلى الدين وهم ليسوا من أهل الإسلام مثل القاديانية والبهائية أو أهل البدع كالرافضة وغيرهم. هذه القاعدة أن ما يثيرونه هم أو غيرهم من المستشرقين أيضا ومن تأثر بهم مع الأسف وما أكثرهم، هذه القاعدة أن كثيرا من المعتقدات الباطلة أو الشبهات التي يثيرونها تعود لأمرين.
The Shaykh said he's going to give us a principle which helps us to repel a lot of the doubts that come from atheists or some people who claim to be Muslims, like the Qadiani and the Bahiyya, or even the Rawafid, the people from Ahlul Bid'ah, or even the Orientalists. And a lot of people have been affected by what these Orientalists have said, is they come out with different doubts and different doubts again, talking about the Aqeedah. So the Shaykh is going to give us two ways on how to deal with these doubts.
الأمر الأول أنهم يثيرون شبهات ومسائل وتستند إلى أحاديث مكذوبة باطلة عن رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم.
The Shaykh said that usually what they do is they base an argument on a weak hadith which is not established at all.
والأمر الثاني أنهم يستدلون بآيات ويستدلون بأحاديث، ولكن هل هذا المعنى لهذه الآية وهل هذا المعنى لهذا الحديث كما يقولون ويدعون؟ ولو نرجع إلى كتب التفسير وكتب الشروح وإلى أهل العلم نجد أن هذا الكلام باطل وفاسد أصلا، ولكن يظهر للناس هذه المعارضة ولكن في الحقيقة هم على خبث وفساد المعتقد يأتون بهذه الآيات أو الأحاديث ويظهروها للناس بوجه آخر، يحرفون الكلم عن مواضعه.
Shaykh said another way that they cast doubts into people and create contradictions is that when they get an ayah or hadith which is correct, which is authentic, but they put their misunderstanding onto it. So we ask them, have they understood it the correct way? Have they understood it the way that it comes in the books of tafsir or the books of explanation of hadith? What they do is they'll take something and they will put a misunderstanding to it. And if we return back to these sources, we will see that the way they've understood it is completely false. There is no basis for that kind of understanding that they're trying to promote. But what they will do is they will run with it. They will get this doubt and they will try to spread it. And what they will do is they'll create a false aqidah or a false belief behind it. And then they will change the understanding from its correct place.
على سبيل المثال تجد القادياني هؤلاء الكفرة الذين يدعون أن غلام ميرزا نبي وأوحي إليه بزعمهم، لما يذكرون الآية ما كان محمد أبا أحد من رجالكم ولكن رسول الله وخاتم النبيين، يقولون خاتم النبيين لا يعني أنه خاتم الأنبياء لا نبي بعده، إنما خاتم بمعنى الزينة، كيف أن الخاتم لما يكون في الأصبع هو زينة هذه الأصابع، فمحمد صلى الله عليه وسلم هو زينة الأنبياء ولا يعني أنه لا نبي بعده. فانظروا إلى كيف، انظروا كيف هذا التفسير الإبليسي للآيات وقلب المعاني ورد أصول هذا الدين بأن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم خاتم الأنبياء ولا نبي بعده، ولو كان موسى حيا لما وسعه إلا أن يتبعه، أن يتبع النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم، وغير ذلك من الآيات والأحاديث الدالة على أن محمدا خاتم الأنبياء وأن هذا الدين هو الدين الحق ولا دين بعده، أن الدين عند الله الإسلام، وأن محمدا صلى الله عليه وسلم هو خاتم الأنبياء والمرسلين. يضرب بهذه الأمور كلها عرض الحائط ويأتوا باستدلال سقيم يضحك به على عقول من لا علم عنده.
The Sheikh said, I'll give you an example. There's a group called the Qadiani and they believe that it's a person called Ghulam Mirza who receives wahi, who receives revelation after the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. But Allah says in the Quran that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is the last prophet and he is the seal of the prophets. Khatim is the word to mean seal. However, what they do is understand the word khatim in a different way. Khatim can also refer to a ring. So they say that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is the most beautiful of prophets, but it doesn't necessarily mean that he is the last prophet. He's beautiful like a ring. So the Shaykh is saying that look how they have given it a tafsir which is from Iblis. They're getting an ayah and they change the meaning completely. They take the very basis and the fundamentals of our religion and completely destroy it by using this ayah and understanding it in an incorrect manner and applying it in an incorrect way. And the hadith and the ayat are extensive to show that the Prophet ﷺ is the last prophet. The Prophet ﷺ said that if Musa was alive, he would have no option except to follow me. And the Prophet ﷺ and the Shaykh saying that there are many evidences to say that this religion is the last religion. It's the one that abrogates all of them that came before us. And there will not be another Sharia and there will be another prophet after us. But look at the way that they're trying to change this very fundamental of our religion by using legislative matters that they're trying to understand the text by, which some people might even just laugh at because it's so far-fetched.
وأذكر لكم موقفا حصل معي مع واحد من فرقة من الفرق التي تنهج نهج الغلو في النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم وبدعائه والاستغاثة به، ولم يبقوا اسما لله إلا وضعوه من أسماء الرسول صلى الله عليه وسلم إلا لفظ الجلالة. وفي عندهم من التعلق بالشرك الجلي الظاهر يا محمد يا رسول الله وغير ذلك الشيء العجيب. المهم أنه كنت في أحد المعاهد مرة درست فيها، وفي البداية كان كشف بأسماء الطلاب للحضور، وأنا أقرأ الأسماء، أحد الطلبة اسمه فيما هو مكتوب عبد الرسول، فأنا لما رأيت الاسم هكذا ناديته عبد رب الرسول.
The Sheikh said, I'm going to tell you a story about something that happened to a person, an incident that happened with him, with a person that belongs to one of these groups that have extensive exaggeration for the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. This group make dua to the Prophet, they seek his assistance, they ask him to remove harm from themselves. And the Sheikh said that there's not a name except the name of Allah, there's not a name that Allah has except that name Allah, except that they apply it to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. This is the extensiveness of their exaggeration to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And the Shaykh said that within this group you can see clear amounts of shirk where they supplicate to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam saying, Ya Muhammad, Ya Rasulullah. So the Shaykh said the story is like this. I was basically teaching in an institute and I had the register of the students that were there in that class, and he saw one of the names and the name was Abdul Rasul. So the Shaykh said that how can this person be a servant of Rasul? It can only be Abd for the name of Allah. So the Shaykh said, maybe it means Abd, the servant of the Lord of the Rasul, maybe. But the Shaykh said, continue.
بعد يوم أو يومين جاءني وقال لي يا شيخ، قلت له تفضل. قال الله عز وجل يقول قل يا عبادي الذين أسرفوا على أنفسهم لا تقنطوا من رحمة الله. قلت له نعم، ماذا تريد من هذه الآية؟ قال الله عز وجل يخاطب النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم يقول له قل، أي أنت يا محمد قل، ماذا تقول؟ يا عبادي، يا عبادي الذين أنفسوا على الذين أشرفوا على أنفسهم لا تقنطوا من رحمة الله. انظروا كيف التفسير، والله الإنسان لو يجلس يمكن دهر وهو يقلب إنه هل يمكن أن يفهم من هذا، ما يخطر في باله هذا الاستدلال.
Sheikh said after a couple of days he came to me and he said, Sheikh, I want to speak to you. And the Sheikh said, Fadl, come, you can speak to me. And he said, Allah says in the Quran, oh, you have wronged yourself. There's an ayah that said, Kul ya ibadi. It starts with Kul ya ibadi. You have wronged yourself. And Allah talks about that the doors of repentance and forgiveness are open for such a person. So the Shaykh said, what's the point? What is the point that you are trying to make behind this ayah? So the person, the student, says that Allah says to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, Kul, say, you say to them, Ya ibadi, my servants, as in the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, is the one who is saying this, that you are the servants of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, seek forgiveness from the Prophet. So the Shaykh is saying, look at the tafsir that he's given to this ayah. Would anybody recite this ayah over and again would ever come to such a conclusion?
ضربوا بآيات العبودية لله، سبحان الذي أسرى بعبده ليلا من المسجد الحرام إلى المسجد الأقصى موقف عظيم، ومع هذا وصف الله بالعبودية. ذهبوا بقول الله لن يستنكف المسيح، لن يستنكف المسيح أن يكون عبدا لله ولا الملائكة المقربون، وأمثال هذه الآيات كثيرة جدا، ولجأوا إلى التعلق بالعبودية لغير الله. فانظروا كيف الفهم السقيم وصرف الآيات والأحاديث عن معانيها وما ينتج عن ذلك.
Sheikh said then they discussed, and the Sheikh was explaining to him that there were many ayat in the Quran which show that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was actually a slave of Allah, and describing Isa, Allah says that he is not a proud person who is to be a slave of Allah. So the Shaykh said that he provided many evidences to prove that the Prophets were actually slaves of Allah. But look at the understanding that he gave to this ayah, where he is changing the actual meaning.
وَأَخْتِمُ كَلَامِي بِوَصِيَّتَيْنِ فِي هَذَا. الأولى أن الإنسان إذا طرأ عليه شيء فيما يبدو أنه من الشبهات في حديث ما أو عدم التوفيق أو الجمع بين هذين الحديثين أو بين الحديث والقرآن أو بين آية وأخرى أن يراجع أهل العلم.
Shaykh said, I conclude my lecture with two pieces of advice. He said that if you ever come across a hadith or an ayah which you feel that there is a contradiction in it, or you feel that is a matter that is doubtful for you, then go back to the scholars and find out the correct understanding.
وَلَا يَتْرُقْ نَفْسِهِ الْعِنَاءَ الْعَنَانِ لأن الشيطان يتمكن بعد ذلك قد تظهر شبهة ثم تزداد ثم الشيطان قد يفسد عليه دينه.
Shaykh said, don't leave it to yourself to try work it out by yourself, because the shaitan might come to you slowly, he might put something in you, and then you might think that you're upon the right way, and then he'll come again and make it even worse. This will actually increase the situation in a bad way for you.
الوصية الثانية أن المسلم لا يعرض نفسه للشبهات ولمن يثير الفتن والتشكيك في أمور في ثوابت وأصول هذا الدين.
Shaykh said, the second advice that he'd like to give you is that a Muslim must be someone that stays clear away from getting into matters which are doubtful, which are matters that may seem contradictory, or matters which are a fitna, or matters which may put a doubt in the very basis of this religion, the actual fundamentals of the religion.
والنفوس متفاوتة في قوة إيمانها وسعة علمها والمقدرة على الرد على بعض الشبهات أو بعض المسائل التي تطرح. ونجد كثيرا من الشباب لم يكن عنده انحراف في كثير من القضايا، لكن مجرد أن يقلب في اليوتيوب أو في وسائل التواصل هذه الحديثة يسمع بعض الناس وبعد ذلك نجده فتنا وانصرف، لم يكن بعد ذلك يحمل هذه الآراء. لماذا؟ لأنه عرض نفسه. وهذا مثل الإنسان المريض الذي يذهب إلى مكان موبوء والعدوى تنتقل، والتحذيرات بعدم المخالطة والحجر الصحي، والدول تنبه لا يذهب ولا أحد يخرج ولا غير ذلك، وهو يأتي ويدخل نفسه في هذه الأماكن. لهذا يتنبه المسلم لهذا الأمر.
Shaykh said that people in their nature differ in their ability to reject or refute doubts. Some people are stronger in iman, some people are stronger in knowledge, some people have the ability to refute doubts and refute contradictions that may come about. The Shaykh said, especially in today's day and age where you find a lot of youth, they don't have the ability and the knowledge to refute these doubts. But with the changes that are happening with social media, etc., it's very easy, and some of them expose themselves to listening to these areas of doubts. So it becomes a fitna for themselves, to the extent that they're not able to turn away, they're not able to refute these doubts and then leave these issues which are doubtful and which create these contradictions. So what he's doing himself, he's exposing himself. And the Shaykh is saying this is his second advice, that the Muslim shouldn't expose himself to these doubts and contradictions. The Shaykh gives an example, is that if there's a land where there is a contagious disease and the people are saying don't go to that land, the countries are warning against it, there's a health warning, etc., and you decide to go to that land and then you get the illness, then whose fault is that? You have exposed yourself and avoided any kind of instruction and just gone ahead and mixed in that contagious environment. So the Shaykh said this is something that we have to pay a great deal of attention to.
وما ذكرنا من حديث النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم من يرد الله به خيرا يفقهه في الدين هذا حديث عظيم يتأمله الإنسان بأن الذي يوفقه الله عز وجل الفقه في الدين وفهمه هذا هو من إرادة الله الخير للإنسان، فيحرص الإنسان على ذلك حتى يعبد الله على بصيرة. ليس المهم أن تعبد الله، لكن أن تعبد الله على بصيرة وعلم لكي تقبل هذه العبادة. ولا نجد كثيرا من الناس يعبدون الله في أديان متعددة، ولكن هذا الدين لا بد من الإخلاص لله عز وجل فيه، ولا بد من أن تكون العبادة على طريقة النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم، ولا سبيل لذلك إلا بلزوم طلب العلم والاستفادة من العلماء والرجوع إلى كلامهم وسؤالهم، وبذلك يعصم الإنسان نفسه بإذن الله من الفتن مع سؤال الله الثبات، وأن يزيده بصيرة وعلما وفقها. وأسأل الله سبحانه وتعالى بأسمائه الحسنى وصفاته العلى أن يوفقني وإياكم لما يحب ويرضى. اللهم متعنا بأسماعنا وأبصارنا وقوتنا ما أحييتنا، واجعله الوارث منا، واجعل ثأرنا على من ظلمنا، وانصرنا على من عادانا، ولا تجعل مصيبتنا في ديننا، ولا تجعل الدنيا أكبر همنا ولا مبلغ علمنا، ولا تسلط علينا من لا يرحمنا. وبارك الله فيكم وجزاكم الله خيرا على الدعوة من هذا المركز، وأسأل الله سبحانه وتعالى أن يبقى مركزا ينير للمسلمين طريقهم، ويكون مركزا أيضا لدعوة غير المسلمين، ويهدي الله عز وجل على أيديكم. أقول هذا وأسأل الله التوفيق والسداد لي ولكم، والحمد لله رب العالمين.
The Shaykh concludes the lecture by quoting the hadith again, that whoever Allah wants good for, he gives them knowledge of the religion. The Shaykh said that this is a great hadith. If you ponder on it, you will find that having understanding, the correct understanding of the religion, is extremely important. And if you have this, that means that Allah wishes this goodness for you. So it's upon us all to seek this knowledge so that we can have this correct understanding, so that we can worship Allah based on this firm level of insight and knowledge, not just that we worship Allah without having any knowledge, because having knowledge and worshipping Allah will be a way that it will be accepted from you. So the Shaykh said that there are many religions that worship their deities, but they don't have the correct knowledge. Islam teaches us that we have to have sincerity to Allah and having knowledge by following the Sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam properly. So the Shaykh is reiterating that it's upon us all to seek knowledge, go back to the scholars, ask Allah to protect us, and ask Allah to keep us firm upon the religion and give us the best of understanding and give us steadfastness. And the Shaykh concluded by making dua for us and asking Allah to aid us, asking Allah to protect us in our senses and our hearing and our sight and our and everything that is around us, that we inherit good from those people above us, and that we give the inheritance of good to those below us, that he helps us when we are oppressed, and not that we make the dunya the main concern and that we make the akhirah our main concern. And the Shaykh was saying, we concluded that he hopes that this center continues to be a center of lightening the path for people to see the correct message of Islam, and that we can use this markaz to give da'wah to the non-Muslims. And the Shaykh concluded by blessing, asking Allah to bless us all. Anybody got any questions?
طبعا في نعم هنالك اسماء نعم يعني من بينها مثلا الحاشر يحشر الناس لو عند قدم صلى الله عليه وسلم، وفي اسماء يعني عديده الان ما استحضرها بالضبط، في عدة أسماء ثبتت، بس هنا يضعون أسماء الله يا شيخ، عرفت؟ يعني يضعون أسماء الله المقصود.
ترجم بس. The brother was asking. The Shaykh mentioned that in the talk that some people are attributing names of Allah to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. But the brother was asking, are there names besides Muhammad for the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam? And the Shaykh said there are other names like Hashir, who will be the one who guide.
Or Mahi, الذي محلا به القطايا يعني الاتباع كالماهي والحاشر والمعقب لا نبي عقبة.
The Shaykh continued, he said that there is Hashir, the person who will gather everybody on the Day of Judgment. Al-Mahi is the one who has his past sins forgiven, or by accepting the message you'll have your past sins forgiven. He is the Muaqib as well, that there is no prophet after him. And the Shaykh said there are other names that are already as well established for the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam as well. So on.
بعض الناس ينكرون سنة وبعض الناس ينكرون علماء فكيف مثلا بإيجاز اختصار هو موضوع كبير ولكن باختصار ما هو شرايع الإسلامية التشريع الإسلامية ما هو وما الأدلة على ذلك بارك الله فيك.
وكما ذكرنا فيما يتعلق بالسنة يعني إنكارها مفتاح الإنكار، إما أن يكون إنكار الحديث بالجملة هذا كفر محض الذي ينكر الحديث تاما، أو تأتيه أمور إشكالات يدعي التعارض أو لا يتوهم التعارض فيها، هذا أمر يعني أهون، لكن يحتاج إلى بصيرة حتى لا يتوسع الأمر عنده ويؤدي إلى التشكيك يعني في الدين. ما يتعلق بهذه المسألة تكلمنا عن يعني بعض الجوانب بما يتناسب مع الوقت. أما الكلام في حجية الحديث وما يتعلق به فكلام يعني بحر يعني كما لا يخفاكم. هؤلاء الذين ينكرون السنة هل يدعون الإسلام بمعنى أنهم يؤمنون بالقرآن بزعمهم؟ إذا كانوا يؤمنون بالقرآن بزعمهم يناقشوا، لأن هذا القرآن الذي يؤمن به كما يدعي القاضي هؤلاء القرآنيين الذين يسمون أنفسهم يناقشوا من القرآن، بأن القرآن هو الذي يأمر بطاعة الله وطاعة الرسول، القرآن هو الذي يقول وما أتاكم الرسول فخذوه وما نهاكم عنه فانتهوا، وهو الذي يقول وما ينطق عن الهوى إنه إلا وحي يوحى، وهكذا. هذا كان إذا كان يؤمن بالقرآن، هم حقيقة لا يؤمن بالقرآن لكن دعوة أنهم قرآنيين، لكن حقيقة ليس بقرآنيين. فإذا كان هذا ينكر السنة ويزعم ويدعي أنه يؤمن بالقرآن يناقش من خلال القرآن. أما ينكر السنة وهو لا كافر أصلاً يعني لا بالقرآن ولا بغير القرآن هذا شأن آخر كأي ملحد من الملاحدة أو أي كافر من الكفرة.
The brother asked the question, we're living in a time where people are rejecting the Sunnah, so what is our advice to them? As Shaykh said, it's a very lengthy topic, so lecture in itself, but he said that there are different types of rejecting the Sunnah. You know, some people completely reject the Sunnah in its entirety. And the Shaykh said that this is clear kufr by you know, rejecting one of the sources of Islam. The Shaykh said that there's a lesser one where people reject some of the hadith because they find it problematic or contradictory. The Shaykh said that in this situation you open dialogue with the person, you speak to him, you give him advice and you explain the correct way. But you do it with wisdom, because if you don't do it with wisdom, it could make the situation even worse. He's saying that there's other people that completely reject the Sunnah, but they affirm the Quran. So they completely reject the Sunnah, but they affirm the Quran. The Shaykh said that in the same situation as this, we will open dialogue with these people, because as long as they have something of Islam, we can use the Quran to establish the fact that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is someone that should be followed. Surah An-Hashr, where Allah says, "Follow what the Prophet or take what the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam gives you," and in Surah An-Najm, where the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam has been described as speaking from revelation and not something from his own desires. They say that they follow the Quran, but they're not actually Quran followers based on what we've just established here. The Prophet ﷺ is ordered or commanded to be followed in the Quran. But the Shaykh said that if you find somebody who's completely outside of this spectrum, they don't follow the Quran or the Sunnah, then that takes another approach.
I want to talk to you more, but I can't.
من سنة السنة حسنة ولا بدعة؟
السنة الحسنة أحسنت. السنة الحسنة التي أصلها في الدين فعلها النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم. يعني مثلا لو نحن في منطقة جاء أحد التحق صار أعفى لحيته جيد، والناس ما شاء الله رأوا هذا تمسك بالسنة ففعلوا فعل هذا سنة حسنة. جاء إنسان وضع مكان لثلاجة يشرب منها الماء مار الطريق أو كذا، هذا سنة حسنة. وضع في مسجد ثلاجة نحو ذلك، أنه مثل هذا الماء أو توزيع المصاحف أو كذا، يعني جاء في الحديث ما يدل على فضل الإطعام، فضل يعني كون الماء الناس ينتفع به أو كذا. فكون الشيء له أصل فعله النبي عليه الصلاة والسلام، ها؟ فهذا يدل أنه مشروع، ومن فعل هذا الفعل واقتدى الناس به هذا سنة حسنة. تأتي امرأة مثلا تتحجب وتغطي مثلا وجهها وتحرس، الناس رأوا هذه المرأة ما شاء الله حريصة، فجاءت واحدة واقتدت بها، بمعنى تأثرت حركتها لتفعل هذا الفعل، هذه سنة حسنة. أما يأتي إنسان بشيء يحتفل بالمولد يقول هذه سنة حسنة، ويأتي 3-4 يفعلون فعله، هذا المولد من أين جاء؟ ما فعلوه للصحابة ولا التابعون مئات السنوات لم يفعل. كل هؤلاء لا يحترمون الرسول ولا يعظمون شأنه ولا يفرحون به بزعمهم، يعني ما يعقل. هنا نفرق بين السنة الحسنة أو كون هذا الأمر يعني بدعة، ولعله اتضح إلى حد إن شاء الله. أنا أستاذ لا بد أن أخرج وتترجم لهم الكلام، في مشكلة. من عنده سؤال على أي حال يمكن يرسل للشيخ يعني بالواتساب أنا أجيب، ها؟ يقول أي من عنده سؤال أنا معكم اليوم وبكرة إن شاء الله، يرسل للشيخ هذا يتواصل بالواتساب أنا أجيبكم إن شاء الله. سبحانك اللهم وبحمدك أستغفرك وأتوب إليك.
The brother was asking a question just quickly, Barakallahu Fik. Shaykh is pressed to leave, but the last question here is that how can we differentiate between a sunnah which is hasana or revived and something which is a bid'ah? The Shaykh said that the sunnah which is hasana, which is revived and followed and the people following it will get its reward, is something which has a basis in the religion. So the Shaykh said, for example, if you see people who don't have a beard and then somebody starts growing his beard and the people start following that person and growing a beard, they will see that they will get the reward because this is something which is firmly established in the religion. Also the Shaykh said that, for example, if you have a fridge and you put it in the masjid, which is quite common practice in Saudi Arabia, and you put inside it water and food, then what you're doing is you're starting a precedence of people sharing food, sharing water, being kind to one another. Again, this is something which is firmly established in the religion, and anybody who does that afterwards will have the same reward. Again, the Shaykh gives an example of a sister. Nobody's wearing hijab, but she starts wearing hijab, and then they see that she has become pious and she is somebody that is somewhat of a role model, and she then affects other people and they start wearing hijab as well. All of this is firmly established in the religion. Something which is not established in the religion, it has no basis at all, then this is considered as an innovation. This is a bid'ah. So the Shaykh gives an example of the mawlid, where the people practice celebrating the birthday of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. 3, 4, 5 people that get together and they have a celebration or party. This is not from the correct understanding of the religion. And is it conceivable that the Salaf who didn't do this had no respect for the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and didn't want to practice his celebrating his birthday? So this is the differentiation. The sunnah which is established or revived is something which has a basis, but bid'ah is something which has no basis. هذا والله أعلم وصلى الله على نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. سبحانك اللهم وبحمدك أستغفرك وأتوب إليك.